so I thought it would be interesting to look at some music that wasn't hymn-based. And I was going through my own collection of pieces, and I have there are one or two hymn pieces, but I was going through my collection and finding things which I might recommend you looked at. And then I thought, well, it would make sense, more sense for me to go to the music store, which is here, with music that's available, and to quickly see what's here. So they gave me permission to go in and shoplift. And I am taking this back. But I dug out three or four things here. And if you don't know them, I will play them to you and just let you hear what they're. Is there. I'd be very interested to hear what repertoire you do play, how you choose your repertoire, if there is anything you recommend to anyone else. My knowledge of American repertoire is fairly short and fairly shallow because I haven't lived here all of my life, so it's the repertoire I'm learning, particularly the choral repertoire actually. So I'd be very interested to hear what the composers that you look out for, what you look out for in your choice of repertoire. Anyone care to share?
I play in a Presbyterian church, very short prelude time, so I look for something really short.
Right.
And I play a lot of Charles Callahan, because you can pick it up and play it.
Yes.
Most of what I do is I have to think of it.
Yeah.
So there's nothing expanded anywhere, you know, and it's really what I call music service playing,
right,
rather than organ literature. Mm-hmm. There's some G. Drummond Wolfe, I can't even remember the publisher, but they're very easy. I'm not averse to pedals at all, but
no.
Those do not have pedals.
Yeah.
I like Dale Wood arrangements.
Mm-hmm.
I like to play early English,
yeah.
Handel, Oxford Press, the Oxford Press.
And I mentioned that collection, didn't I, before, that early English organ music.
But, yeah, for me, I don't have very much time. I work full time other than Wednesday and Sunday.
Yeah.
And so, luckily, with this minister that they have now, years ago when I started there, the minister wanted like 10 and 15 minute preludes, which, you know, I couldn't do.
No.
So for me, it's short, and I hate to say simple, but
it's practical.
Yeah, very practical.
Absolutely.
So.
Well, I always take comfort in, as I said earlier in the week, I always take comfort in the fact that Bach was an extremely practical musician. Mm-hmm. And if you look at Bach's letters, he writes all sorts of comments about the musicians he's dealing with, and comments about the poor violinist and the poor trumpeter that they sent along that week. And he dealt with four boys' choirs. I mean, he was actually director of music, I think, four choirs at the top. And there was the A choir, and then there was the D choir. And I think, you know, the music that he wrote for the A choir is considerably more difficult. And so he was extremely practical, down-to-earth musician. We sometimes put composers on little pedestals, and we forget that they were extremely practical, worked in real life situations. So that's really, really, really interesting. I have to do a 10-minute prelude. Well, I don't have to. I normally play a 10-minute prelude. Yeah, for big services, I have been in situations where I've had to play half-hour preludes, 45-minute preludes, and you're almost writing an organ recital program for those. At the church I'm at, the request came that I note the prelude on the bulletin, and I don't know if you're doing that. I find that very good because it gives me the discipline to actually commit to a piece on the Tuesday, normally, in our situation. Makes me practice it. And if I'm really crazy, I'll put a piece I don't know and learn it in the 2 or 3 days if I have the time to do it. Well, Charles Callahan, that leaves as a collection. I don't know if you know this collection or not. It's a collection of postludes. And as you say, it's very approachable music. It's very very straightforward in many ways. There are a couple of pieces in here which are transcriptions, and there are a couple of original pieces. I was watching his presentations at this conference from a couple of years ago, and so I was seeing what he did when I was preparing for my week. So let me play you a couple of these, and you can hear. And this is this is available at the store in the foyer. I can't see what the price is, but I'm sure they will let you know. This is a piece called Aeolian Fanfare. Doubling in the left, and so that gives you one hand free. You can be clever.
What's the name of the collection?
The collection is called Alleluia. How appropriate, yeah. The poster collection, published by Morningstar, who I think publish most of it out. Publisher I know well. Thanks to Morningstar, I'm here. Because the director of Morningstar is Mark Lawson, and Mark is a good friend of mine. And I think he's on the Yes.
I didn't see those the first day. I just saw the music by the window.
Right.
And then the second day I went, oh, they do have some stuff.
They do. And as I said, you know, on my very first session, there's always those internet sites, which are incredibly useful. There is a transcription of the rigadoon in here. I won't play the whole book, but I did actually set this organ up this week. Charles Callahan obviously intended that one to be fairly big, and this does say it's a book of post-its, I guess, so, yeah, but I'm never afraid of a loud prelude. I don't know about you. I occasionally will play a loud prelude. I bought some music of my own, and I'll show you this collection in a minute. That Isabel on Monday played at Herbert Howe's Psalm Prelude, and they're fairly advanced pieces, but they go up to full organ in the middle of them, and I'm never afraid as a prelude to play a piece that goes into full organ, particularly if you've got a congregation that's used to listening to the prelude. If a congregation that isn't will talk louder the louder the organ goes. But it's also sometimes a fairly good tactic to get a congregation quiet, is to play something loud and then come to a halt and then play something soft, because as soon as you finish, they realise they're silent and they shut up.
Would you play
offertory
standard with violins?
Yes, I play offertories particularly in non-choir services, and I will. Again, that's a variable length. The problem with offertories is they're variable length. And, you know, I will talk a bit about that more tomorrow, perhaps, but I know some of you aren't going to be here. But, you know, I will perhaps play a piece and then, if I need to, will improvise or a little bit in the style of, or else we'll try and locate lots of good cadence points. I try to avoid going into places that are going to take me into foreign keys. So if I've got a piece in, like, let's think, F major, and I end up in A major, there's a section, say, in A major, which is very extremely rare, but I would tend not to go there. I would keep myself to a fairly limited section of the piece so that I'm always in control of that final cadence. Now, we have a closed circuit TV system which allows me to see what's going on, because in my church I'm behind a screen. No one can see me. I can't see anything. Everything's going on behind me. We have little cameras. We have set up some online wireless cameras to help me see what's going on. And I'm looking at the camera, making sure, because I don't get nods or anything like that. I'm just expected to know when everyone's ready. The Episcopal Church during the offertory, they're getting the communion altar ready and getting all the bread and wine set up. So it's quite a process. And my cue is to watch for the clergy washing their hands, because they wash their hands ceremonially before the Eucharist, and that's always my cue. I call it the washing up music. That's the So yes, I mean, I play for Off the Trees. Sometimes on Sunday morning, I will improvise. I will. Isabel referred to it as doodling. That's a nice term for it. You could play. And the only thing about doodling to me is to actually give some structure to that. And again, I'll talk about that tomorrow. But I play Off the Trees and I play Post-its, and then I play during the communion, the administration. That's usually something quiet. I sometimes will play a hymn for people to sing. But, that's yes. I mean, there's a fair amount of play in the morning. But I, as I said, I'm never scared of playing something loud as a prelude. I think I wouldn't do it every week, but I think as a change, it's really good. I played for a big funeral on Monday, and I started with a big Bach prelude. That was one of those half-hour preludes. Played the big Bach prelude fugue just to open the proceedings, so that gets people's attention. The person concerned was a particularly lively, vivacious lady, so it was music that was entirely fitting for her as well. This collection has. Say it looks like two or three original pieces, and then some transcriptions, and that seems to be a very useful collection. I'd recommend all of this. Staying with postludes at the moment, there's a transcription in the store here, which is a lot of manual work and some pedal work, but it's by Nigel Potts. It's the overture for the Occasional Oratorio by Handel. And Handel is a wonderful resource for the Royal Fireworks music. The water music have wealth, as you, I'm sure you know, have wealth of pieces in it. There's a great collection called Ceremonial Music for Organ, which is published by Oxford University Press. It's a red book with a really nice picture on the front. Of St. Paul's Cathedral, and that has some very, very good arrangements of the fireworks music, La Réjoui songs. You know that piece? And that's really, really useful for all sorts of things. Nigel is handsome. I picked this out partly because I like to name drop occasionally. Nigel's a good friend of mine, there he is. He's a wonderful, wonderful player, based in New York. But let me give you a taste of this. This requires a little bit of nimble finger work, but you'll recognize it as a city of St. Albans again, which is my one of my great loves. I've told my wife, not being too morbid, that I want a little bit of me scattered in St. Albans when that day comes. Canticle of the Rose was written by Alan Ridout, you ever come across that name. Alan Riddell was an English composer, wrote some very approachable music, wrote some really nice, actually some really quite nice church music as well. Was well known as a secular composer, but lived in Canterbury, was based in the city of Canterbury for a while. He wrote this collection, for St. Albans Cathedral they had a large blank window, a window just full of plain glass, and they filled it with stained glass. It was in the north transept. And the dedication service was in front of royalty and everything else. And they commissioned Alan Riddell to write this collection of pieces, which is to me extremely useful. The titles reflected the themes of the window. Earth, Father, Fire, Sun, Air, Spirit, Water, Postman. And anything, it's all very approachable. It's not difficult. It looks difficult. As the water piece, for example, looks harder than it is. The other pieces look a little hard, but they're actually not that bad, because there's a lot of pattern in it. And there's a lot of manual work. The pedaling is fairly light in many of the pieces. And so you can pick and choose. I find this very useful for Pentecost. I find this very useful for particularly Trinity Sunday, if you observe those Sundays. And because the themes are there, and it's extremely useful. There is a real nice variety, of quiet and loud and strong. And let me play you something. Let me play you a little bit from this collection, because all I've played so far is loud music. Here is the piece entitled Sun. Any feast or any Sunday where you're focusing on the sun, the Son of God, or there's even in the run up to Christmas, I think this is very meditative. It's a manual's only piece. I said yesterday, I always have something drawn on every manual, just in case.
Thank you.
language and slightly more modern feel to that. But I think that's really quite effective music. There is, he has written an optional pedal part in that. I didn't play it with pedals because I wanted to see that everything was possible in manual. But that's a collection which I evangelize a little bit with that collection. But anyway, let's go back to what I found in the store. There's a collection here by Robert Lau, and I have a pupil in Little Rock who chooses her repertoire, which she plays quite a lot by Robert Lau, and she always makes me laugh. She chooses her repertoire if it says anything slower than Andante. That's how she chooses what she plays. Anyway, but this is very approachable music, very approachable. Some of you may know these collections. This is a collection called Adoration. And again, there's some hymn pieces in here, but there are also some non-hymn pieces. This is a piece called Cantilena. I won't play it all, but I'll just give you a taste of this style. It's very, very approachable. And we can do exactly what he asked for in terms of registration. It's very clear about what he wants. Sounds, and there's little hints of other melodies in there as well. I thought it sounds a little bit like Handel at one point. It sounded like the Largo from Xerxes, or Ombre My Fui, as it's known. So that's in the store. That's published by Lorenz. That's $15. Is music expensive? That scares me that it's so expensive. I've still got music that has pounds, shillings and pence on it from the pre-1971, which is when Britain changed its currency. I still have that. I don't have any music that has euros on it, I don't think. But that's when Britain goes into the euro, that's when I should stop buying music. But that's that collection. It's called Adoration. And again, very, very practical and very immediately useful. I have three meditations for organ, published by Morning Star again by Ryan Patton. These are based on hymns. There's How Firm a Foundation, Let All Mortal Flesh Keep Silence, and The God of Abraham Prays. Let All Mortal Flesh Keep Silence is very, very popular with organists because it's and there was an arrangement we sang last night. So let me play to you The God of Abraham Prays, which is the version here.
Thank you.
referred to 20, he was a great lover of 20th century music, or 21st century music now, I guess, but he would have referred to wrong notes. That's music with some nice wrong notes in it. It's just a phrase I've come to use myself. It's really quite nice. Those dissonances sometimes really work. So I think that's a nice collection. It's not difficult. It's not fearsome by any means, and it's just something a little bit different from the usual some of the usual hymn preludes we see out there on the market. There are a couple of collections which I'm aware of, and you probably are aware of them too. The Easy Organ Library. This is volume 53, so you can have a really big organ library. A lot of hymn pieces in this, and a lot of two-stave writing. So instead of just putting in on three staves, there's a bit of two-stave writing, which makes, I think, things easier to read. It's a really useful mixture of things, and again, particularly I think if you're probably in the fairly last minute it's frame of mind and needing something, there are some books in there called The Last Minute Organist, which I didn't get a chance to really look at, but the title just intrigues me because I'm sure we've all been there. Suddenly realised during the service you've forgotten to pick a piece. The great advantage of where I am is because I'm hidden. I can get up and about and scurry and shout when no one sees me. Here's a piece from this collection. It's called Reflection. I'm just looking through. This I confess is new to me.
Thank you.
I've come across these before myself. The best of them since the Cecilia series, Sunday morning orchestra, you know, there looks as though there's some slightly more complex music in there, but not greatly. some E-power bigs arrangements, which are nice. My daughter is called Cecilia, so anything that has Saint Cecilia on it, I don't know. She's not the saint yet. She's just the Cecilia. Again, that clearly is a useful collection that's in there. Let me see if there's a piece in here I can play to you. Here's a festival piece on Nicaea by Jerry Westenkoop. John B. Dykes arranged by Jerry Westenkoop. Christmas, you can repeat. Christmas is way easier as a church musician than Easter because everyone thinks it's a really hard time. Holy Week, I find that you have to have music. There's music you can do on Maundy Thursday, you can't do any other day of the year. Good Friday, you can't do any other day of the year. Palm Sunday, you can't do any other day of the year. And it all comes on top of one another. And then Easter Day, you get there. And you have to suddenly get all this other music out. In my experience, Easter Sunday is usually the most under-rehearsed day of the year because the music for Holy Week is so glorious. Because composers, do you notice that composers are very good at being miserable? They're extremely good at writing about sin and death and how horrible and miserable they are. Just listen to Allegra's Miserere, or you know, that glorious piece that has those I see something like that. And they sing this, they write, and even the madrigals that talk about the secular music from that period, from the certainly the Tudor period, that talks about losing their love. It's always they're very good at misery composers, and they're not so good at happiness. And I find that Easter music is sometimes a real disappointment. To find good Easter music to me is very tough. That, you know, choral repertoire particularly, and there's plenty of good joyful organ music which isn't directly related to Easter. I normally play the Fedor Toccata on Easter Day because there are people who love that piece, and that's always a I call it a money piece. It always ups the collection that Sunday when I play that. I don't know about you. I worked in one church where the instruction was, this was in America, the instruction was on the second Sunday in November to play on Christian soldiers. And there was a sort of legacy to the church that was almost dependent on that. When I was in Chelmsford, instead of Memorial Day in Britain, we have a Sunday during November called Remembrance Sunday. And there's always a big ceremony associated with that. And the instruction was to play that piece by Elgar Nimrod. Do you know that? Yeah. That wonderful tune. Which goes twice as slow as that. It's a wonderful piece to look out for, by the way. And the organist got £50. So we always used to fight to see if we would play that piece. There was £50 in it. So there are some collections that are available here at the conference, and just, you know, my cursory look through over the last couple of days, and particularly with an eye to I know I've played a couple of hymn pieces today, but with an eye to non-hymn repertoire, and I think there's some really useful things in there. And my when I was going through my collection at home, I was looking through some sort of slightly more unusual repertoire that I enjoy playing. And then I was trying to find things that again weren't too crazily difficult. There's a wonderful collection, if you like French music, a wonderful collection by Marcel Dupré. It's called Le Tombeau de Titelus. Now French music's very expensive. That's the only problem with buying any music by French composers. But Dupré was a lot of Dupré is just impossible because he was such a virtuoso. But there is music he wrote that is very, really approachable. These pieces build up in difficulty as they go through the collection. I think there's 15 of them. And number 15 is a little more tricky. But the early pieces are really very, very approachable. The first two are Manuel's only pieces. They're based on plain song charms, and I'm going to talk about plain song tomorrow when I'm talking about the liturgical year. It's plain song, a wonderful resource that in the nonconformist tradition we're not nearly as aware of as we probably should be. Just listen to this. This is a. This is actually a Christmas plain song chant that he just wrote this. And he also writes all his fingering in. So if you're learning this, he writes fingering in for him. Because I think he wrote this for his pupils. But I think this is really beautiful. that's not music which, that's not Dupre, which is fearsome or anything else. And say those plain song charts, which aren't immediately recognizable melodies all the time, but they provide the basis for certainly a lot of French music. A lot of the 20th century French music uses that plain song. There's a really beautiful piece based on the evening Te Luce Sante Tenor, the ancient hymn as well. Let me just play you a little bit of that. I won't play you all of it, but let me just play you the first line so you get the flavor of that. The Lord before the close of day is the English translation. Just a couple of other things, because our time is gone. Edwin Lemaire, I mentioned the other day. There are some books of his original pieces, which are very approachable. He also wrote some really quite fine transcriptions of songs. There are secular songs in here as well as some more religious-minded songs. The London Derriere, there's a wonderful arrangement of that in here.
Is he American?
He was British, I think. Okay. I think he was British. He was a very, very famous recitalist, one of the great virtuosos of his day, and he wrote many transcriptions. And Wayne Leopold, a few years ago, got the copyright to them all and republished them all. And extremely, extremely useful collection. There's about there's 8 volumes of transcriptions by itself, and then there's original pieces. There's at least 7 volumes of his original work. So very prolific. If you want chorale prelude, it's a bit different. There's fairly standard repertoire, but Brahms is always that wonderful Christmas piece, Essestein Rolls, which is really, really beautiful.